Welcome to Cambridge House Live. I'm Vanessa Collette, joining you from Vancouver, British Columbia. And this morning I'm speaking with Frank Holmes, CEO and Chief Investment Strategist of US Global Investors. Welcome, Frank. It's great to see you.
It's good to be here from Carmel.
Now, Frank, oil seems to be in a free fall. What is going to be the fallout from this?
Well, it's going to have a significant impact positively globally. Some countries will take it in the chin, in particular Russia, which is now imploding, Venezuela, which is imploding. It's also creating a peace dividend actually with Cuba because they can no longer get cheap fuel from Venezuela. And they're in negotiations today with America. So I think there's some real positive ramifications globally. And just looking at numbers, it's about $1 billion a day that's going to be injected into the industrialized world. So Europe will get a rebound. America, Canada will take a difficult to exporting. However, the rest of the economy, everyone's seeing in Vancouver, the gas pump prices are declining.
So you see it as being bad for Russia and Venezuela. I mean, we certainly saw it in their currencies. I think the Russian ruble was just hitting recently an all-time low, and Venezuela is probably not too far off. But it being a boon for the Western economies.
Yes, and don't forget China, Taiwan, Japan, Thailand, all these countries, Indonesia, India, Chindia, affectionately known as, is 40% of the world's population, and they import all their oil. So what does that do to them? It's a huge, huge tax break for them. And that's going to show up in consumer spending. And so the jewelry stores have been on a fire. Tiffany's is hitting a 52-week high.
Wow.
So I think that's where you're going to see where it's a difficult one hand, it's a huge peace dividend to the world.
Now, what does this mean for North American production?
What does it mean? Well, fracking will slow down, and the decline rates from fracking are very, very high. So that supply that's coming out of the fracking area will drop off quickly in a year from now. And then you'll see oil prices probably trade back up to the $80 level.
Okay, I was going to ask you if you saw it more as a short-term pullback or a longer trend. But sounds like you think it's going to be bouncing back.
Yes, I think these things always have a 50% bounce from where their high to low is, and then they try to find their footing globally. And if the world's economic engine gets ignited, where we're seeing PMIs out of China being weak, we're seeing it in Europe, if they all start to turn positive, the correlation to higher energy prices and all commodity prices is very high. So it's going to take about 6 to 9 months to get this traction. In the interim, you, the spender, the consumer, are going to have extra money every week to go and spend.
And what does this mean for shale and oil sands companies?
They're going to have to redo their budgets. They're going to have to streamline, and I think there'll be lots of cost pressure that'll take place like we've seen in the mining sector, which has already been going through this long, 3 year? This is the fourth year of stocks declining, but where you're having 2 years and you're seeing CapEx start to drop dramatically.
Now, Frank, what's your investment strategy when you see this kind of a short-term pullback?
Well, have cash to be able to buy things that have the highest cash flow yield. So those that have the lowest cash flow yields from 6 months ago have fallen the most, and they're going to have the most difficulty. So they're going to have to do the most significant cuts to survive. And I think a key factor took place in the energy patch was this takeover in Canada of the Spanish company Repsol taking over Talisman. That is basically saying to you that you're getting a floor because of the sheer size of the transaction.
Now, what's your sense of China's current potential right now?
Well, it's going through a big change, and the huge infrastructure spending projects have been cut back except for railway systems being built throughout the nation. And there have been a big focus on consumers and creating a healthy infrastructure for consumption domestically. I think that China's just going through this sort of interesting process that they've also had a big impact on casinos in Macau because they've had a crackdown on political leaders that are taking back kickbacks. So that crackdown will be beneficial, and that'll start to show up in a year from now.
And what are you seeing on the global PMIs?
Well, something that we've written about and we follow because there's a high correlation to global PMIs. And when you use that expression is Purchasing Manufacturers Index, and it's a forecast of what people think they're going to be building and making. So anytime they start to rise, then they have to use more commodities to manufacture a product. So it's a significant factor that's highly correlated to the resource sector. So when we have what we have found in our research is that when the 1 month global PMI, which comes out by JP Morgan every month, the 1 month is below the 3 month average trend, then all the commodities take it on the chin, unless there's significant supply restrictions. When it goes above, there's a 70 to 90% probability of copper rising, iron rising, oil rising.
Are you bullish on copper at the moment?
Well, copper is one of those interesting commodities that there's a big debate on how much supply is coming into the marketplace versus people are shorting it in sympathy with the other commodities. But I think in a year from now, it trades higher.
Now, let's talk a little bit about the U.S.'s decision to end quantitative easing. How does that correlate with the oil prices?
Well, I really find that that's a difficult question to really look for a correlation, because I've not really looked at it to see something. I think what's really much more important, as I just mentioned, are the PMIs. I've written about it. It's on our website, and we've shown those that analysis, and it's become extremely sensitive since 2008's economic global slowdown, that crash and that rebound. The capital markets have morphed, they've changed. So it's very responsive to PMIs.
Now, clearly markets aren't really stabilizing right now. Are there any safe places where, you know, safe, smart places where you're recommending that people put their money right now?
Well, first of all, there's a big imbalance between monetary policy and fiscal policy. If you recall, the G20 countries would always meet, and it was about world trade. We're not seeing that today. It's about tax and regulations, synchronized global tariffs. So I think that that does change how money flows back and forth. So that means that we're going to have to live with lower interest rates. The only way they truly get huge economic synchronized growth like they did pre-2008 was when you had the G20 countries meeting and it was all about trade and tariffs dropping. So where do you put money today? I think you can buy so many wonderful companies that pay dividends, which are much higher than a five-year government bond in Canada or the U.S. Look, if you want to talk about gold, you buy Franco Nevada. You get a dividend higher than a five-year government bond. You have 70% profit margins. You have an incredibly balanced, strong, robust balance sheet that's going to grow.
Frank, so you're still an advocate of mining stocks at the moment.
Well, what I've always advocated when it comes to resources is 25% should be exposed into resources. And in that sector of resources, one can take a look at refineries. Cheap gas means that they can manufacture end products and they have huge profit margins. And those stocks have been on a tear with growths of 60 to 70%. So I think companies like that are important. When it comes to gold, I've always advocated a 10% weighting and rebalance each year. And so the rest should be in equities. And there are many great dividend-paying companies. And I think there are going to be significant long-term investments to look for dividend growth in a low interest rate environment.
Right. And what do you think of the smaller royalty companies?
So when you say smaller royalty, are you talking about energy or are you asking about mining?
Mining.
In the mining sector. Well, I think if they have a dividend policy, that's what's important, because then they have to be really conscientious of their capital. So in our investments, we own the bigger ones, the Franco, the Royal Gold, and Silver Wheaton. They're the three amigos.
Do you have any products, I guess, at U.S. Global that you're recommending to investors right now?
Well, like I mentioned earlier, it's near-term tax-free. It's just got a spectacular low volatility, steady eddy growth for the past 14 years. And then our All-American funds that are dividend-paying, and they're focused on companies that are buying back their stock, reducing their debt, and increasing their dividends. That's all it buys. And then when it comes to the resource end, I think that some of these energy companies are offering spectacular yields in this huge sell-off, and one just has to take a look at those that have the highest cash flow yields and some of the MLPs that are going to benefit from this continuous infrastructure build-out. They're not vulnerable to this oil decline. I think that they're the companies to be taking a look at.
Moving back over to mining, I think you mentioned that Colombia has been a bit disappointing this year, but Ecuador is looking good. So what's your take there?
Well, in all our perspectives, we say that government policies are a precursor to change, and one has to take a look at what their monetary and fiscal policies are. Colombia has become a populist, sort of socialist agenda, moving the goalposts, whereas Ecuador was extremely socialist, and they realized all the capital left, and now they've had to reinvent themselves. And you see Lucas Lundin coming in and creating a new gold mining company to build out in Ecuador because the government's changed their policies. So they've recognized the damage money's left them. So I think that that's positive for Ecuador.
Just as we wrap up, Frank, what's your take on gold right now?
Well, gold's DNA of volatility is plus or minus 15%. That's what it normally moves up and down over any rolling 12-month period. So gold could correct $150 or jump $150. The significant factor that's been a drag on gold has been the U.S. dollar's strength. And the U.S. dollar's strength is the rational reason, because they're importing less oil, their balance sheet looks better, and also long-term interest rates. When gold hit $1,900, a U.S. government bond had a minus 3% rate of return, a 10-year government bond. Now it's plus 50 basis points. So that swing of real interest rates, what the government will pay you, whenever it's positive, the dollar is strong, gold is down. So we'll just have to watch as this unfolds. Long term, gold will trade higher.
Great. Well, Frank, it was a pleasure having you on the show today, and we'll look forward to seeing you in Vancouver, January 18th and 19th. You'll be delivering some keynote presentations there?
Yes, I'll be doing a couple of keynotes in the morning, different days, and an afternoon panel, which will be very exciting, with Ross Beattie on commodities and what we see and think. And there'll be other people on the panel, but Gianni will be there, and so it'll be good.
Excellent. Well, thank you so much for joining us today, Frank. It was a pleasure.
It was great.